So the other advisor recommendation that I thought I'd drill in on is around unsupported Kubernetes version. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the cadence of the Kubernetes project itself, how that's being reflected in AKS, how we consume new releases into the service, and why it's important for you to stay up to date. Then I'll talk a little bit about the upgrade process, as well as an alternative best practice that we've seen a lot of customers follow around using node pools for consuming new Kubernetes versions, and some of the work that we're doing, capabilities that you can take advantage of if you're looking to follow that best practice. So the Kubernetes project is fast moving. It is shipping new minor releases about every 3 months on a fairly consistent cadence. So the most recent release was 1.18 at the end of March. 1.19 is scheduled to be released at the end of June. So those are minor releases. Patch releases are then shipped as required for bug fixes and security patches. So this is 1.18.1.2 and so on. In the upstream project, only the latest release and the last two minor releases are supported. So at any given time, you've got roughly the last 9 months of releases being supported, up to the last 9 months of releases being supported. And what this means is that if you're running a version that is older than that, you may be running one that has critical security vulnerabilities, certainly potentially performance issues and other bugs. But security vulnerability is obviously the most important here. And what we've seen is with the growth of Kubernetes, it has become a greater target. There's been a notable increase in the number of CVEs that have been highlighted over the last year or so. And so it is that much more critical that you're staying up to speed with Kubernetes releases as they come out. So in AKS, we try to stay up to speed with the upstream project as much as possible. So we have mapped our support matrix to that upstream process. So we also support three minor releases at any given time. And the way this works in terms of the process is you'll see a new minor release or new minor version released upstream. Typically, that'll be incorporated into AKS within a matter of weeks as a preview. And at that point, we will announce the pending retirement of the oldest minor release after 30 days. You have 30 days notice if you're on that minor release to move forward before you fall out of support. After that 30-day period, we graduate the new minor release to a GA'd state, and at that point drop the oldest one off the back. Now, it's important to point out that clusters that are running those older versions don't stop working. The applications that are still running within them remain available. However, you do have potential vulnerabilities that are running in there. You're not going to be able to consume new improvements that are shipped. And if you do create a support issue, that's something where customer support will typically ask you to upgrade to get onto a supported release, as there's obviously a lot of changes that go into these releases every 3 months. So, how do I actually consume those upgrades? Well, as a managed service, AKS provides a first-class upgrade capability. So you have the ability to upgrade the cluster either as a whole, so both the control plane and all of the associated node pools, or you can do that individually. So you can invoke a control plane only upgrade and then work your way through the node pool so you have full control over those versions, with the only caveat being that the control plane always needs to be at the greatest version within the cluster. So the node pools can be behind, but they cannot be ahead. Now, of course, it's the node pool upgrades that are the most interesting, and that's where we get into the value of something like a pod disruption budget. So the way that those work is we initially will add a new node into the cluster, into the node pool, with the target version. So if you're moving from, say, 1.16 to 1.17, the new node will be based on 1.17. Then we will pick one of the older nodes and perform a cordon drain operation similar to the one that we just saw, where we'll try to drain all the existing workloads off of that node and move them elsewhere within the node pool until that node is completely empty, at which point it'll be removed, a new node will be added, and then that process continues until all of the nodes have been moved forward and replaced with ones that are running on the new version. Now, obviously, that fully automated upgrade process is very convenient, and for a lot of scenarios, it works beautifully. But there are certain use cases where it has drawbacks. So first of all, for very large clusters, it can be slow. So as we're following a node-by-node upgrade process and requesting that each of those pods gracefully terminate, that is something that can take a certain amount of time, and then at the very least it is out of your control, so you don't have the ability to manage the creation of the new nodes or the ordering of draining of the old ones, and so if that's something that where you want to have a little bit of more oversight as part of the upgrade process, the built-in upgrade experience doesn't allow you to do that. So what we've seen is a lot of customers end up following an alternative approach using node pools, where rather than running that node by node upgrade, they will actually create an entirely new node pool targeting the new Kubernetes version. So again, maybe a new node pool targeting version 1.17, and then they will drain the nodes themselves on the old node pool, which will force the rescheduling onto the new nodes, and then once all of that, all the old nodes have been drained, delete the node pool. So at a high level, it is effectively following the same process the built-in experience does, but you're able to create all of the new nodes as a single operation, and then control the ordering and the timing of draining of the old ones. So you could drain a handful of nodes, get the pods reschedule onto the new nodes, make sure that everything's running correctly, and then continue with the process as opposed to having completely outsourced that to the service. So with that in mind, we've been making a bunch of improvements to our node pool support. So the first one is we've introduced the notion of node pool types. So the background here is you have a set of system services that need to run on your node. So this is things like Core DNS and its autoscaler, metric server, the tunnel, and others. And those are services that are critical to the health of your cluster. And so they need to be kept running. They need to have dedicated resources. And so it's typically a best practice to isolate those components into their own nodes so that you can then run your applications completely separately from them. And so we've now elevated that idea into a first-class concept where you can signal that a particular node pool is a system node pool, and that's the default one that gets created with the cluster, and then subsequent node pools can be created as user node pools to run your application. So it creates a nice way of segmenting the different workloads that are running within the cluster. Within user node pools, you can use those to run either Linux or Windows pods. They can be made up of either spot instances or on demand. We'll talk about spot here in a second. And then critically, they can actually scale down to zero nodes. So while for the cluster to remain available, those system services that I mentioned need to continue to run. Your application, if it doesn't have any work to do and can actually scale down to nothing, you can likewise scale the associated infrastructure down to zero. And so you can really manage that that set of resources associated with your user node pools. We've also added the notion of spot node pools. And so this is built on top of the Azure Spot capability that became generally available recently. And this is an evolution of the low priority capability that we had previously within VMSS. And so the idea here is to allow you to get unused Azure capacity at a pretty steep discount, so up to 80% in some cases, while being mindful of the fact that that capacity is not guaranteed. So if it is needs to be reclaimed for other customers who are willing to pay full price, then your nodes will get evicted. But for certain workloads, namely things that are maybe lower priority and certainly things that are very tolerant of interruption, so batch jobs, machine learning type workloads, this can be a very nice way to get significant discount on your compute costs while still running in an AKS environment. We recommend that you associate the cluster autoscaler with a spot node pool such that if a node does get evicted based on capacity constraints, that the Azure Fabric can attempt to redeploy it elsewhere within the environment, which will show up as just a new node within your node pool. The autoscaler can manage that process for you. So just a couple caveats here. One is that spot node pools cannot be upgraded. So because of the way that we run that upgrade process and the need to provision new nodes, because we can't guarantee that those new nodes will be provisioned in a timely fashion, we won't allow you to start an upgrade process. So you should think of these spot node pools as being effectively tied to the version that they are created with, which then ties back into that best practice around performing upgrades via a new node pool creation. And then they cannot be used as system node pools. So obviously we want to have dedicated resources to run those system services. And so spot node pools should be really reserved for user applications. With that, I will say thank you for attending this virtual session.